In this video, we are going to discuss part 3 of vibration control. Previously, we had already discussed two other ways to control vibration. First is the controlling of natural frequencies by changing the mass or stiffness of the system. Number 2 is the vibration isolation. And finally, in this video, we are going to start discussing about vibration absorption or vibration absorber. What is vibration absorption all about? In principle, suppose you are having mass 1 or you have a specific machine, you would like to protect it from vibrating and you have this external vibration. Because you would like to protect the machine from vibrating, you are adding this additional mass. The purpose of this additional mass is to so-called absorb the external excitation, the external vibration, such that the vibration of the machine is at minimum. Now, there are several things you need to understand about this. Because we add a new mass spring system, now our system becomes a 2 degree of freedom system, and consequently it has 2 resonant frequencies. As well, the values of the absorber mass and stiffness, we need to design it, we need to choose it such that the motion of M1 is at minimum at the sacrifice of the motion of M2. So we do not really care if our M2 is vibrating too much. What we care about is to make sure that M1 is not vibrating too much. This concept, we mainly find it in a lot of machines that run at constant speed, you know, such as compactors, motors, etc. Among other examples, we can find vibration absorbers are in Stockbridge damper, you know, the small things you can see in the transmission line, as well as in tuned mass damper. This is a giant mass added to the structures to make sure that a huge structure such as this Taiwan Taipei 101 is not vibrating too much. Let's start discussing the gist of the concept of this vibration absorption. Of course, we are starting with equation of motion. We have now 2 mass spring systems with 2 equations of motion. And from here, assuming steady state solutions, of course, we arrive to this steady state amplitude of vibration of M1 and M2. Because we have 2 masses, we have 2 equations of X1 and X2. Us engineers are always interested in normalizing equations like this, or, you know, to make it non-dimensional so that this kind of equation can apply to many other conditions. By setting these 3 equations, such as this static deflection, as well as your omega, the equation of omega for omega 1 and omega 2, and you do the math, rearrange the previous equations, now we can arrive to 2 equations of so-called magnification factor. Let us just call it magnification factor because the concept is similar to the one we discussed earlier. This is the equation of capital X1 divided by static deflection, whereas this one is capital X2 divided by static deflection. Now, let us try to interpret it. Capital X is the amplitude of the response in steady state. So just let's try to think about it as the response of the system and divide it by this static deflection. So meaning we can think of it as how much it is magnified as compared to the input. Of course, we want this value to be as small as possible to make sure that the vibration in mass 1 is at minimum. And that is why there are several understandings toward these 2 equations. And the first one is there a strategy to minimize the value of X1 over static deflection? And yes, there is. If we look at closely this equation of X1 of static deflection, in the numerator, we have this 1 minus omega divided by omega 2. Now, if we set our omega 2, which is the natural frequency of the mass 2, the second mass, to be equal to omega, we are going to set this to 1 and 1 minus 1 is 0. So that's why we can set this variable, the value of this variable, to be 0. And usually, most commonly in the design of vibration absorption system, we are also setting our omega 1 to be equal to omega as well. By having this relationship, we can arrive to this relation between mass 1 and mass 2. And finally, the ratio of K and M for mass 1 and mass 2 to be equal. However, typically, we are going to select the value of mass 2 to be much less than mass 1, as well as for K2, it should be much less than K1. Second thing we need to understand about these equations is the value of X2. So we need to ask about the value of X2. Under the same condition of this, all frequencies to be equal, what about the value of X2? We can look at this term here. This will be set to 1, and that is why this term will be reduced to 0. And that is why the denominator here will be just left with this minus k2 over k1. And that is why we can reduce this whole equation of x2 of static deflection to be this equation. And remember that your static deflection is f0 over k1, and that is why your x2 k2 is minus f0. What does this tell us? It tells us that the force exerted by the additional mass, or this mass 2, is opposite to this excited force. We can think of it conceptually as if this is being absorbed wholly by mass number 2. And that is why the concept we are discussing here is termed vibration absorption. Also, if we try to work out the mathematics one more time, we can arrive to this equation x2 is this. x2 is a function of m2. So now if we would like to change the value of x2, we need to work out the value of m2. And usually, this x2 is the design condition to be met. We do not want our mass number 2 to oscillate by certain factor, say by 2 millimeter is the maximum condition. So by having this condition, we can set the value of m1. Let us now look at the graph of the magnification factor. This is the graph of x1, and let's review. We have this original graph in dotted line. So this is the case without the absorber. Your y-axis is the magnification factor, x1 compared to the static deflection, whereas your x-axis is your frequency ratio. Now this is just like the case of an undamped for vibration, having just a single peak corresponding to this frequency ratio of 1. But now we are having our absorber being added to the system. That is why we are shifting to these solid lines with two different peaks corresponding to two different resonant frequencies. We can find the two resonant frequencies by using this equation. And finally, there is this concept of bandwidth or self-operation as well. Of course, because we would like our system to operate within this proximity of frequency ratio of 1. And once our frequency ratio, say, due to the shifting of the the external vibration, it can shift to the right or it can shift to the left. And this will make our system to have a very terrible oscillation. So the system will meet the resonance oscillating very wildly. So by defining the value of maximum allowable amplitude, say we want the allowable amplitude to be around 2 times of the static deflection. Now we can determine the range of frequency ratio that is safe. So this is our bandwidth of safe operation. We are moving on to a sample problem. So we've got here a small machine with a weight of 250 kg with this stiffness, and it is supported on a mount. It has been observed that the machine induces vibration into the surrounding area through its mount at this operating speed. So this is our omega. Now we are asked to determine the parameters of the vibration absorber, meaning we need to determine the value of K2 and M2 that will reduce the vibration. The magnitude of the exciting force is 750. This is our F0, and the amplitude of motion of this second mass is to be limited to 1.5 meter. This is our capital X2. Let us now set our known parameters, and of course we can start with the concept that the amplitude of motion of the absorber, your M2, should be equal and opposite to that of the exciting force. And we can use this equation that your K2X2 should be equal to minus F0, or we can just take the absolute notation here. So that is why we can first find the value of K2 to be 500 Newton per meter. Having obtained the value of K2, we can use this equation to work out your mass number 2, which is 50 kg. Let's now do a quick validation. We remember that there is a ratio of K and M that applies to both mass 1 and mass 2. K1 over M1 should be equal to K2 over M2. So if we do a quick validation, K1 over M1 is 10, and your K2 over M2 is also 10. So they are fine. Let's play around with this app of vibration absorption so that we can appreciate and relate further to the sample problem. Now we have M1 here that we want to protect. Say this can be a machine. And we can design the absorber by setting the values of M2 and K2. You know, we can set the values of M2 and K2 here, but let me bring it to the default. We can also change the value of omega here and F0. Now, look at this system. This system under this condition is in the safe zone. Why? Because the value of omega 3.16 is equal to omega 1 and omega 2. That's why x1 is 0 here. x1 is operating at 0. And the mass 1 does not move, as you can see from this animation. In contrast, x2 is oscillating, but we don't care as long as mass 1 is protected. Now let's observe what happens when we shift the omega, the exciting frequency, to the right. We can shift it to the right, and you know the system can meet to the second resonance. And of course we can shift it to the left as well, so that the system will move and then it will meet the first resonance at around the value of 2.4. The frequency ratio of 2.4. It is also noteworthy that the concept of normal modes apply here as well. Just look at the mode of vibration in the first and second resonance. They are different. In the first resonance, as you can see in this animation here, both masses, they move together synchronously up and down. Whereas if you look at it again at the second resonance, they are moving in opposite phase. Let me set this back to this original value, 3.16. Let's also check the graph of x2, because remember what we've been discussing so far is the graph of x1. I can click this to turn to graph x2. We can confirm here that x2 is not 0. And M2 is oscillating. Now this graph of M2 is also useful. This will become necessary when you want to control the value of X2. Remember that the value of, you know, this capital X2 is a function of M2, the second mass. You can look back point number 3 in my explanation. Finally, I think I want to show you the concept of bandwidth, the safe bandwidth to work with, and how we can change it. Let me bring it back to the graph of x1. Remember that the ratio of k2 over m2 must be 10, but to design and to meet that design requirement, there are many possibilities. Now let's look at this table, and with this given default value, K2 is 500 and N2 is 50, we can check to see how much is the value of big omega, the capital omega. We see here that the value is around 2.5, and then your omega 2 is somewhere around 4. That means you have the difference between omega 1 and omega 2 to be your so-called bandwidth. Now let's try to change the value of M2 and K2. As long as they meet the ratio of 10, it still works. So let us try the value of K2 equals to 200 and this M2 to be 20. We can check it one more time, the value of omega 1. So it is shifting. It is shifting. Now your value is around 2.68 or 2.7. And then your omega 2 is somewhere around 3.65. And so here comes your new bandwidth. Finally, let me try when the value of K2 is 1000 and here it is 100. So notice that the ratio is still 10, and then the value of omega 1 here is somewhere around 2.28, and then your omega 2 is somewhere around 4.3. Now you notice that the largest bandwidth is found when the value of M2 is the largest. So at the final example, the bandwidth is larger, but then again, the bandwidth gets larger at the cost of large M2, the large value of mass 2. Most of the time, we do not want mass 2 to be so large or to be very close to M1. So this is a trade-off problem in designing your vibration absorption system.